In this video, we'll be addressing how and when to use the Z or T test, including how to find the conclusion of a hypothesis test. So let's begin. So if we want to determine when to use the Z or T test, we need to know if the population standard deviation is known or unknown. So you should be able to read the problem and tell if the standard deviation given in the problem, as you can see, SD, standard deviation, is 5.5. But does this come from a population or a sample? And so just looking at this problem, we can see that you obtain a sample of size n equals 20. And from the sample, we have a mean of 77.2 and a standard deviation of 5.5. So this is a sample standard deviation. You should be able to read in the problem and tell if the standard deviation comes from a sample or a population. So since we know that this comes from a sample, then population standard deviation is unknown. So we're going to use a t-test. The z-test, as you can see, population standard deviation is known. So z-test, population standard deviation is known. So we want to use the t-test. Okay, so now looking into this problem, let's fill in the given information. Well, we were given the null and alternative hypothesis in this problem. We have equals, so it doesn't take into an equation. And we'll put less than. So notice, as always, that the number that goes in the null and alternative hypothesis is always the same. In this case, 80.9. We have the level of significance, which is 0.002. Oh. And now we have the sample mean. The sample mean, as mentioned before, is 77.2. And then we have a sample size of 20, n equals 20. The sample standard deviation is 5.5. Now we have filled in all of the orange cells, and we have the standard deviation of the sampling distribution, which isn't really needed for this problem. We have the p-value. Now there's three different p-values. Which one are we going to use? Well, since we have in cell C6 less than, then we're using column 18. And I have it italicized here in this case. And so this is 0.0036, rounded to the correct amount of decimal places, round appropriately. And you have p-value. Now you should be able to determine if we are going to reject the null hypothesis or fail to reject the null hypothesis in our decision. So our alpha is 0.002, our p-value is 0.0036, so the p-value is actually larger. So we're in this category here. So we are going to, and I'll go ahead and bold, underline, and italicize, go ahead and do that. So we failed to reject the null hypothesis. Okay, something also to read in the very beginning of the problem, you wish to test the following claim, HA. So it's stating here that the claim is HA. So this is the claim. We need to know that when we actually find our final conclusion, because we want to directly address the claim. You always directly address the claim when you make your conclusion. Okay, and we want to figure out what it means in our decision to fail to reject the null hypothesis. What does that mean in terms of our claim? So if we fail to reject the null hypothesis, that's essentially saying, if we're failing to reject, that's kind of a double negative. That's essentially saying that the null hypothesis is correct. So this is correct, and this is not correct. So if the claim, which we're addressing, is not correct, we need to figure out which one of these is mentioning that. So notice that it is all four of these are directly addressing the claim, which is less than 80.9. So all these say less than 80.9 at the very end. Now let's see which ones actually make sense. We can narrow it down maybe to a couple of these. There is sufficient evidence to warrant rejection of the claim. So we want to, the claim is not correct. So warrant rejection of the claim, that might be correct. That might be correct. Let's come back to that. So one is a possibility, the first one. There is not sufficient evidence to warrant rejection of the claim. Well, we are rejecting the claim essentially because we determined it's not correct. The claim is not correct. So if there's not sufficient evidence to warrant rejection, so that is not a good option, actually. It is not that there's not sufficient evidence to warrant rejection. Well, there is because we've determined that it's not correct. So this is most definitely not correct. The second option is no good. All right, let's look at this one. The sample data supports the claim that it's less than 80.9? Well, that's the same issue with the second one. We don't want to support, we haven't found that we want to support the claim. We're not supporting the claim because the data is not supporting the claim because we know the claim is not correct. So that is not a possibility. So the second and third option, most definitely not correct. There is not sufficient sample evidence to support the claim that the mean is less than 80.9. There's not sufficient sample evidence to support the claim. That's kind of like the option one, that they're very similar. They're both saying that the claim is not correct. But which one is the one that we really want? And it comes down to the wording. Which one is addressing it appropriately? Keep in mind when we say we reject, that is always in terms, and it comes back to our decision, either we reject or we fail to reject H-naught. H-naught is not our claim. H-naught is what we reject or we do not reject. So when our claim is not the null hypothesis, our claim is the alternative hypothesis, you do not word it that way. You never word it like option one. There is sufficient evidence to warrant rejection of the claim. No, you only warrant rejection or do not or fail to reject the null hypothesis. You always word it that way for the null hypothesis. So option one is not correct. Let's see what option four looks like, our other option. There is not sufficient sample evidence to support. That's how we want to word it. Rejection is for the null. Support is for the alternative. There is not sufficient sample evidence to support. That is how we want to word it. That's how you break down your decision. It's based on the wording. And keep in mind, reject or do not reject is always for H sub zero. And we want to directly address the claim. So option four is the correct option. All right, so that is how you do a hypothesis testing and decide between a Z and a T test. And how I address this conclusion is very similar to how you will break down any type of hypothesis test if you have to break down the conclusion and determine the conclusion of a hypothesis test.